game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Definitely a very good afternoon and a warm welcome to Game On. It's a fun Friday, and tell you what, Real Madrid are certainly Spanish champions for a record 34th time from last night, and for Manchester United, unbeaten in 19 games, has walked into the FA Cup semi-finals. Manchester United will be up against Chelsea. Man City will be up against Arsenal. That will be at the Wembley. Formula One as well is back this weekend. This time around, they'll be heading down to Hungary. That is at the Hungaroring, in what promises to be quite the cracker, because it's the third Grand Prix for their 2020. It's a makeshift campaign that is happening down in Formula One. And then the fixtures, and certainly the breakdown in terms of the 2022 FIFA World Cup. That is down in Qatar. Obviously, FIFA coming out and confirming that we shall have at least four games every single day when it comes to the group stages. So, hey, going to be quite the interesting one down there. But then locally, there's a lot of conversation, transfer speculation, so many players swapping sides as well during the transfer market, and so many clubs as well are looking to rebuff, especially during this transfer break. So, hey, we shall be talking that and so much more on the show. But first things first, we've got the FUFA Vice President. Yes, that is Mr. Justice Mugisha that does get to join us for the next 1 hour. So if you've got any questions regarding football across Uganda, we'll definitely love to hear from you. So head down to Facebook right now. The page is hot for, that is actually Urban TV, and on Twitter as well, the page is Urban Television. So join the conversation because we'd definitely love to hear from you. Plus later on, we shall also be opening up the phone line 0414-337-872. And as always, I'll certainly be joined by Hope Mugisha as well. But first things first, Mr. Justice Mugisha, welcome to Game On.
Good afternoon, viewers.
Yeah.
I'm glad to be here.
How is FUFA, and certainly how is COVID been treating you guys?
No, during this COVID, of course, we are not playing the games, but we are moving on. Mm. We are making plans, and we have done a lot of things during this break.
And that is something we shall be discussing on the show, because there's been a lot of conversation around the clubs, during this pandemic. Some of them found themselves in a financial distress. That is something we shall also be discussing. But most importantly, post-COVID, how we see the game of football going. But first things first, though, Mr. Mugisha, I want you to say hello to all the viewers, and definitely, send anything to out to them.
Hello, viewers. My name is Justice Mugisha. I'm the first vice president of FUFA, but I'm a teacher. I'm a teacher by profession,
yeah.
And my entry into FUFA is through school football,
okay.
And school sports. And I head school sports in the whole region, FIASA region. I'm the president of FIASA. And of course, above that, because I'm president of FIASA, which is one of the five zones of Africa, I'm also an executive member of African School Sports. And maybe most importantly, I am also the president, technical commission, football for the International School Sports Federation, with headquarters in Belgium. I'm glad to be here.
Definitely. Thank you so much, Mr. Mugisha. And I hope certainly you've got a distinguished one on the show this particular afternoon. We'll be talking everything to do with football across the country. As someone that has worked with football players right from the lower level, he's been involved in sports from right the lower tier. And ultimately, there's a lot of conversation regarding where the game of football is at right now, vis-a-vis where it's heading across the country.
Well, it's good to have you here, Mr. Mugisha, my namesake.
you are my sister.
I guess we have, like Brian said, we have a lot to talk about today. And but before we talk about all that, to me, my highlight, of course, I just love the fact that this time around, especially in the Uganda Premier League, clubs are putting in so much effort to get ready for the next season. Mm. Before we came on air, like maybe around midday, there were news coming in that Ondo Paraka got a new head coach.
Right.
We have always had issues, with clubs getting into a new season. They don't have stadiums. They don't have players. Have not registered. Clubs have not registered the players. They don't have a head coach. in general, you find that most clubs are already disorganized. So I feel like COVID has been a blessing in disguise. It has opened many people's eyes. Now they're preparing themselves for their new season.
All right, Ms. Amgisha, first things first. I think it's fair we start with the financing, funding as well. Because on the date, which was the 24th of, April, I think that is when the first batch of money came through from FIFA. The $500,000 and the FIFA president, Mr. Gianni Infantino, coming out and saying this money was a relief plan, obviously, for the federations. We saw so many clubs jumping on board and saying we need to get a part of this before ultimately a second batch got come through. But first things first, talk to us about that mix-up. Were the clubs misinformed? Were they simply not aware of what was supposed to happen?
You see, when you are hungry and you see food around, you think that food is yours. And therefore, I cannot blame the clubs. But that money came, but it came with strict instructions and also strict explanations. What happened was that FIFA finances each member association with approximately 1.5 million dollars every year. And that money comes with regulations. And the first regulation is that there are some conditions which you must satisfy to get that money. Now, ordinarily, it is easier to get the first batch because the first batch comes in January and it is normally $500,000. And that money, strictly, you have a budget for it. It is mainly for running football. Whether there is COVID or not, that money comes and it has a budget. It had a budget, had already come in January. Now, in April, when the pandemic came, FIFA realized that some federations were immediately going to get problems as federations. And it decided to release the money, which normally it releases in July, to the federation so that they can, it can absorb the shock as it plans for a bigger relief fund. So, but that money, when it came strictly as the money which would have been released in July. What they did, they put aside the conditionalities and they said, here's the money in case you have problems, but still it has to do what it normally does. But they also sent us a form which said, tell us, what problems are you facing? As FIFA, we want football to continue being played. What problems are you facing? So we filled in the form, and as we filled in the form, and we have, because we have dealt with FIFA for a long time, we knew that definitely they were going to send a relief fund, but specifically to make sure that football continues to be played. And I'm very happy to note, when the letter came, of course, we informed our stakeholders. But when we informed the stakeholders, I think there was misinformation through newspapers and what have you, that, oh, FIFA has received the money for clubs. So the clubs came up, but when we had a meeting with them, we explained to them, and we specifically told them the real relief fund is coming.
Because
and I'm glad to note that when FIFA sat, the council passed the money for relief, and the money is about $1.5 million,
right,
which is also $500,000 is specifically for women, and then $500,000 will come in the near future, because I've not seen it, and then another $500,000 will come in January.
Okay.
But there is one thing which I want to say from the onset, even when that money comes, it's not money for sharing.
Yeah.
It's money to ensure that football programs, football continues.
Before probably we come back to that, I'm sure Hope has got a couple of questions for you, but specifically regarding some of these funds.
Well, you said that part of the money, the relief funds you received from FIFA was to help football continue in Uganda.
Yes.
And back in Uganda, the sometimes Uganda Premier League was ended prematurely. Vipers declared champions. The women football competitions were also cancelled. So I just want to understand, this money will be distributed to these clubs maybe when the football resumes, or?
The decision about those that football, the instructions and the advice which we got from FIFA as when they decided, whether this is a fund specifically to make sure that football continues to be played, but not to be shared.
To bail out the clubs.
To bail out the clubs. Not necessarily. Okay, it can also be used to bail out the clubs, because you cannot continue playing football without bailing out the clubs.
Right.
But essentially, it is not a fund which comes and we say how many members, because there are some people who have approached us and said, we are 34 members of FUFA, because FUFA has owners. And actually, 16 of them are the clubs.
Right.
So some were saying, now you get that money, it is $500,000, divide by 54 members, and then give to us. But we are telling them, no, that's not the purpose of the money.
Mr. Mugisha, quickly, let's move to the 27th of June. You know, somewhere around there when the $1.5 million got come through as well. Like you've clearly, you know, stated there, $500,000 towards women's football. The $1 million, though, is where most of the clubs have the interest, not just the top tier, the second tier, the regional leagues as well. We've been informed there's going to be an extraordinary General Assembly to decide the allocation and precisely how it's going to be spread out. Can we have a picture of the breakdown? And some will argue, is it going to be a fair share in terms of giving from the top tier to the lower tiers? Or, you know, priority will be given to the top tiers, and depending on the capacity of the club, that will decide how much they get.
As I said from the onset, I'm saying the money is not there simply for sharing. It is money to ensure that football continues to be played so that the shocks that we have received during this pandemic can be absorbed to some extent. So when we talk about football, definitely we are talking about football. When football, we are talking about clubs right away from fifth division up to the first division, which we call the Premier League. On the Premier League, we have about 16 teams. Then we have the big league, and so on and so on and so on. Then in addition to that, we have the national teams. For example, I would like to inform you that the date for World Cup, Women World Cup, I think has been set in early next year, I think February next year. And you remember that we still have a match to play against Cameroon to determine who is going to
The under-17. Right.
Now, for example, before the under-17, before we can play a match, we must get these girls, camp them. Camp them, ensure that we follow all the SOPs, then play a match. And under the circumstances, definitely it's going to be much more expensive than it used to be. Because if you have to go and play in Cameroon, you have to charter a plane.
Right.
You have to get all the authorizations in time. You have to, so it will definitely cost much more. So if money is used, for example, to make sure that the team, the woman team, the under 17 is camped and is able to play a match and it qualifies maybe, then that money being well used.
Because I'm sure there's people watching out there, especially club representatives, and they want to get a sense of certainty. Should they expect to get something out of this? And if anything, because some of them have come out, including Onduparaka, you know, Tori United, they've, you know, emphasized the point of being under financial distress. Should they at least expect to be considered?
Definitely. They are part and parcel of football, and they are members of football. And this money is not going to be used outside football. And because of that, I can assure them 100% that, yes, they may not get it in the form they expect it, because some, even when they get it, I've seen some club, some players in the club, they say, okay, if Onduparaka gets maybe $10,000, how many are we? So we shall share it according to that. No, it will not be like that. And I'm not, even as we talk now, I cannot tell you that Onduparaka will get this, this one will get this. It is a decision which is going to be made by the at the extraordinary assembly.
Yeah.
And before that, we are going to sit down as the executive committee and make a proposal to the assembly. And if assembly accepts our proposal, definitely that's how it will be shared. And the good news is that the assembly is assembly of members. All the members are represented at the assembly. And much as they are looking at FUFA, at the president, at the vice president,
so every and the club executive has committee a voice
to decide, it will be their members, their delegates, who will decide on how that money will be used.
Okay, quickly, Hope, probably jump in.
Well, just to take you back briefly on what you've been talking about, sharing the money. Let's say you're going to share this money or give it to the different clubs in Uganda. What criteria do you follow to give these clubs money? Do you base it on their financial status or the needs they have? Like, I just want to understand how this money is distributed to different clubs.
Ordinarily, when you hear of, for example, $500,000, it's a lot of money. If you put it in Uganda,
it's about 1.9 billion.
1.9 billion.
Right.
But if you were to look critically at the needs of each club, even the top, in the top tier alone, this money is exactly nothing. And we are saying that this money is not only going to be used for the top tier. We also have the big league, we have the third division. We have, so in Uganda alone, we have more than close to 1,000 clubs.
Okay.
And but the clubs play at different levels. Their needs are definitely different. We shall sit down and see how the 500,000 can ensure that football continues to be played right away from the grassroots up to the top tier.
Of that $1.5 billion, there is $500,000 specifically for women's football, developing the game of football across the women. And you've seen FIFA putting a lot of emphasis on that. For the next 3 to 4 years, they're being very deliberate about growing the game of football for the women. How much expectant should that fraternity be, especially in terms of strengthening structures and making sure that they've got the right, you know, necessities for the game of football for the women to continue the trajectory it's taking? Because you've seen the under-17 girls, totally phenomenal. The Crested Cranes as well have been putting in quite the shift in the recent couple of years. What would you say we are in terms of growing women's football now?
In fact, as far as women's football is concerned, when you ask me, that you are, I'm the right person to ask. Because women football has developed and it had to start from schools. And I happened to be on the normalization committee in the year 2005, and I'm the one who proposed that for football to develop, women football, we must have mass football. And we started a tournament for schools in 2005 in Jinja, which attracted only 5 teams. Mm. But as we talk now, in Uganda, the number of teams, the number of schools that play women football are even above 1,000. So we have now a basis for development. When at FUFA we started the women's league, definitely it was natural that the first team that came up were mainly school teams.
Right.
Although, of course, now, as we continue to develop, we now also have teams which are not necessarily school teams, like the Queens, which belong to our president. Mm. We have not gone beyond that now from having the National League, but now at National, we have 2 leagues, the top and the second. And then now, in Uganda, we have 8 regions. Mm. Now, each region of Uganda is now playing a league. And I'm very happy because the results have come. I know they have come because of those structures. We have also trained across the board very many coaches for women football. We have got very many referees. We started with under 17 and we trained referees when they are still at school. Mm. And right now they are now under 23. And I can assure you we are getting very good referees, women referees in Uganda. Mm. And definitely when we talk about the development of football, we are just talking about 3 things. We are talking about the young being able to play football on a good surface.
The facilities.
The facilities are there. And under the instructions of qualified coaches and also with very good referees. Okay. I can assure you it's happening in Uganda.
Okay.
And we have very many from primary school. Now we have taken it to primary school. Mm. They are praying. We are praying at secondary school. And now, I think very soon you'll see that Uganda is going to be number one as far as women's football is concerned. Because, look, our under 17 team went to South Africa to COSAFA.
Right.
And they took the cup.
Yes.
And they took the cup odds from South Africa, which happens to be like among the top 5 teams in Africa. Mm. And I think it is number 49 in the whole world.
Right.
So that means we are moving very fast. Mm. And we hope that when we meet Cameroon, we shall beat them and then we shall go for the World Cup.
I think that is what every Ugandan wants to see, playing at our first ever under 17 World Cup. Some will say it would be the big milestone that propels the girls going forward. But probably I want to bring in Hope here, and he hints on taking core capacity, building capacity across the officials, across the coaches as well, especially for women's football. How much emphasis do we need to put here? Because at the end of the day, you've seen the talent is there, and the girls have proven that they can actually perform. All they need is that platform. And if anything, so many more professionals that so many fans will be hoping come out.
Well, over the years, we have seen women's sports, you know, being slower, less appealing, and less interesting. But now the fact that FIFA is putting in a lot of effort to grow the sport, FIFA has been, I actually applaud FIFA for doing that. They've been doing an incredible job. Back here in Uganda, we have so many leagues where girls can actually participate in. Last month, we saw CAF introducing the CAF Champions League, Women Champions League, that will commence next season. We have the Women's African Cup of Nations. So the competitions are very many to, you know, grow the women's sport. But my question that I want to ask Mr. Mugisha, as much as FUFA is trying to fund the women's sport and grow it, your work plan emphasizes on growing the women's sport, but from grassroots. One thing I want to understand, how are you intending to make the women's sport more commercially viable and more interesting and appealing to the public? Because we've already seen, I can give an example of SEKAFA that just included. We didn't have so many numbers in the stadiums. I would love to see fans out there in stadiums, you know, supporting the women's sport.
You know, when you read through our strategic plan, you would know that because we have been following this strategic plan for the last 4 years, the current one, you would definitely not be surprised as to why we are doing so well as far as women football is concerned. Now, when we talk about professionalization of the women football, that's exactly where we are going. You very well know that this year we now have two tiers for the National League for Women. One, both of them are national. Hmm. One feeding the other. And then the other one being fed from the regions. Right now we have been doing what we call club agenda for the Premier League clubs and also for the big league clubs. We also are now planning to do the same for the women's team because we want them to be professional. That's our emphasis. And when we talk about funds coming from FIFA for women football, these funds are not only coming to Uganda. These funds are going to every country in Africa. Mm. But it is because of our good planning and our love for women football that the impact of this financing is much better in Uganda than maybe in any other country of Africa. And we are very proud of that.
Okay. Mr. Mugisha, I've got to move on away from our women's football, though. I talk a bit of the league reforms. You know, that was tabled a couple of months ago, and it raised a lot of conversation across different sports circles. A majority of the fans were saying, listen, it's going to water down the quality of competition, and if anything, it's going to make the league a little bit more exclusive. And some teams actually are going to end up feeling like they've actually been closed out. When you mentioned the teams would be reduced from 16 and brought down to 12. Talk to us about the intention, the purpose for coming up with this kind of reform. And if anything, should you expect the public perception to be able to change?
Yes. You know, the problem is people want to things to be done always in the same way, but then expect better results than before. At FUFA, the first time we proposed the big league, because you remember how we used to promote clubs up to the Premier League. You would play in the fifth division and then be able to be promoted up to the Premier League.
Yeah.
So we said that one shouldn't happen. And we said we should have a league which is national, which should feed the top league. Now, we have played the big league, what we call the big league now, for very many years. And it has also become professional. Mm. So it is not fair for someone to say, you are reducing the professional league from 16 to 12. Actually, we are maintaining the number at the top. But what we are saying is that when we talk of the Premier League, we should have teams of very high quality, teams which are capable to play in that very league.
Because even the ecosystem will have gone down, the number of players playing there, the coaches as well, and there will be so many reservations for some of the teams that will be playing in the FUFA Big League.
No, the truth is that we have elevated the FUFA Big League to actually where the Premier League used to be in the past. But we are saying we must go higher and have a higher better organized, high quality league, which is now going to be the UPL. But the big league is going to be maintained. So the clubs which actually have been playing in the Premier League, when they play in the big league, they will still be playing in the league, which is better than the one they used to play in. Because now we have raised standards of licensing, and we are going to ensure that that league, the way it is, the big league, will still be even better than how the Premier League used to be.
I hope, obviously, the question of stakeholders being involved, the clubs are such key stakeholders in this discussion. There'll be question marks about some of them having their own reservations regarding the reforms. Ultimately, we've already seen the reception. Most of them have been a bit, you know, hostile, and some of them have even had second thoughts about this particular one there. But it's going to be a whole consultation process to actually get their side of the story as well.
But I want to say one thing about this. Actually, as executive committee, we have not yet made that decision.
Right.
The decision we made was that let us make a proposal and we push it out for discussion.
So there's consultation.
And I'm very happy. I'm very happy with the consultation that we have had over this. Because everybody, it has forced everybody to go back and look at the principles that make a good competition. As they are discussing, they are learning more. And believe me, you, when finally we decide, we shall make a very good decision where everybody will have been consulted, and everybody's input will definitely be put in mind as we make the decision. But at the end of the day, the executive committee is mandated to make a decision, and it will make the decision. And there are those decisions which are reserved for the General Assembly. It will definitely be the General Assembly where everybody is involved, because this one has something to do with changing the statutes. And there's no way the executive committee can make a decision which impacts on the statutes.
Without engaging them.
It has to be the General Assembly to make the decision.
Okay.
At the end of the day, the General Assembly will make a decision. And when the General Assembly makes a decision, all of the 34 members of FUFA will have made a decision.
There you go. That is the first vice president of FUFA, Mr. Justice Mugisha. Tell you what, in case you've got any questions, you might want to hold your horses, because when you come back after the break, the conversation definitely does get to continue. Head down to our social media platforms. Facebook page is Urban Television. Twitter, the handle is at Urban TV Uganda. We certainly want to pick up your side of the story. Plus 0414-337-872. Try and open up those phone lines a little later on the show. When we come back, though, we'll talk a bit of grassroots football. He happens to be the president of the East African Secondary School Sports Association, and certainly is on the body that runs the sport as well across the continent and across the globe as well. So when we come back, we touch on that, the conversation of infrastructure as well. And then post-COVID, what is the fate when it comes to football across the country? The new normal, like everyone has been saying, how much of the game of football is going to be all the time. And so much more when you come back. You're watching Game On, and it's Fun Friday.
Game on. It's Game On. We are big on sports.
Big stars, yeah.